that actually has the strength as far as the decompression.
Oh, it does. Well, that's a new one.
No. And so look at almost it for a second. Well, it's about split.
It's been harder.
Yeah, that's right.
It is. But I think most of the time,
yeah,
how are you?
Yeah, yeah, they are. They get that.
Oh, we have a product on that too. No.
Just to repeat the rules that we have, each candidate will be given 2 minutes to introduce himself, why you're running for office, and the issues that you want to address. When we get to the debate around, each candidate will have a minute to respond to your question. We'll go to your opponent, and we'll come back and go back through. That way, the intent is to create a dialogue so that you can respond to each other's responses. We will then close. Closing statements will be a minute and a half apiece. No candidates allowed to send or receive text messages during the debate. And we're looking forward to getting to know you better. We'll start with our first opening statements. Mr. Fitzpatrick.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having us here again in Forsyth County. It's always a pleasure. I am Roger Fitzpatrick, and I am running for the 9th congressional seat to represent the people of the northern part of Forsyth County. But let me tell you this, representing the northern part of Forsyth County would also represent the southern part, because everything that you do in Congress represents the people of the United States of America. Tell you a little bit about myself. I was born and raised in White County. Upon graduating from White County High School, I joined the United States Marine Corps and went to Parris Island and spent 6 years in the Marine Corps Reserves. Upon leaving active duty, I got my teaching degree from the University of Georgia and began teaching at White County Middle School, spent 14 years in the classroom, and then the last 14 years I've been in administration. The last four as principal of Mossy Creek Elementary. The United States of America has an unfulfilled destiny. When our founding fathers brought forth this nation almost 236 years ago, they established a form of government never before seen in the history of mankind. And because of that form of government, the United States became the greatest nation on the face of the earth in very short order. And over the past 100 years, I believe, we have seen a slipping away of that level of greatness. The solution to our problems are very simple. May not be very easy to accomplish, but our solutions are very simple. And that is simply returning to the original intent of the Constitution as established by our founding fathers. Those men, in the wisdom and in the revelation, I believe, that they had, they established a form of government never before seen, and it worked. And I want to be one to represent you to return this nation to the level of greatness by following the original intent of the Constitution. Thank you.
Mr. Collin.
Thank you. It is good to be here, back here in this room again. We're traveling all over this district because this is a great district, 20 counties, and all are a part of what I believe is really a focus for the next generation. I made it clear over the last little bit that this is not a two-year election. This is a 5, 10, 15-year election. This is one of those pivotal elections that's going to change us, whether it's from the presidency into the Congress, especially on the national stage. For those who don't know me, I'm Doug Collins, and I'm running for Congress here in the 9th District. I am born and raised up in North Georgia. My dad was a Georgia State Trooper. He was moved to Gainesville before I was born, and so I was raised in North Hall, and that's where I reside even to this day with my wife, who is here tonight, and my three children. I went to North Georgia College. After I graduated from North Georgia College, I began to work in the corporate world, training fire departments and working with hazardous materials training, and also dealing with environmental regulations and dealing with government regulations, where I first became familiar with a lot of the problems that we're experiencing even to this day. After then, about like North Georgia, different mountain turning road, I became a pastor. I pastored for 11 years at Chickpea Baptist Church in Gainesville, Georgia. During that time, I joined the Air Force Reserve, and I'm still currently stationed at Dobbins as wing chaplain at Dobbins. I went to Iraq in 2008, served there, and come home. 2005, I left to go, left the church and went to law school, and I currently have a practice in Gainesville in which I have been a part of now for about 4.5 years since I come home from Iraq. I've also served in the Georgia General Assembly, and I appreciate Congressman Woodall just a few minutes ago pointing out the importance of our state legislature, and it's a privilege for me to serve with my friend Mark Hamilton and Senator Murphy, who are here, because I do believe over the last few years I'm the only one in this race that has a record. That's what I'm running on. It's a consistent conservative action, and I believe experiencing good experience matters, and what we've had here in the state of Georgia over the last few years is moving us toward a business-friendly state, one in which regulations are decreased, taxes have been decreased, you pay less taxes now than when I first entered. That's the kind of leader I want to be. Thanks for being here.
Well, if y'all would, we have Ms. Amanda Nixon who will be up front. She's our official timekeeper. She'll be giving you signals when you have 1 minute, 15 seconds, and we're out of time. First question will be for Mr. Fitzpatrick. Jumping right into it. Do you consider yourself pro-choice or pro-life? Do you believe there are any situations when abortion is justified?
I am most certainly pro-life. I believe the only exception, as set forth by Georgia Right to Life, is when the life of the mother is in danger. I have the endorsement of Georgia Right to Life. I believe that life is most sacred, and I believe that God is the one who gives and takes away. We should not be doing anything but protecting the life of the most vulnerable among us.
Most definitely pro-life. I'm the one thing that I say, and I say it during my opening, is consistent conservative action. This year I helped author the fetal pain bill, which actually banned abortions after 20 weeks in the state of Georgia, convenience abortion. We've taken great strides here in the last 6 years that I've been in the legislature, along with other helps and members of the General Assembly, to actually make life a statement. It begins at conception and ends at natural death. And when we look at that, that's really the statement of life that we have to have. I believe it's something that we hold sacred. Is the addition of the life of the mother is the only exception there. I think what we've got to do is it makes a statement on who we are. And I think when we look at that perspective, it says that we value life in all stages. And that's what I have stood for. That's what I've actually voted on. In fact, in the Georgia General Assembly, there's been two abortion bills that have passed in the last 6 years. I've been on both conference committees on those bills in the past.
Mr. Patrick, Dr. Adams.
Oh, I applaud the legislature for making that move. The Declaration of Independence talks about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness in life. We have got to protect life at all stages. And let me go on to say, not just protect the life of the unborn, but also protect those who are far more advanced in years, or those who have disabilities. I think we all remember Terry Schiavo and the tragedy that was when the Georgia judge ordered the turf feeding tube be removed, and she died of agonizing death. We have got to value life regardless of the condition that it might be.
Mr. Collins, any addition?
I think, you know, really what we've got to look at here is this is, again, about, you know, what you've done and what, you know, inconsistency here. And I think that's the it's been said, and I wish that Ms. Aller could have been here tonight, because this is one of the areas I think that we would have some disagreement on. I do believe that you need legislation. I'd love to change everybody's hearts and minds about different things, but this is a place for the legislature and can stand up for life, and that's what we've done.
This question is for Mr. Collins. How will you work to prevent the federal government from encroaching upon the power of the states?
I think what we've got to get back to when we look at the federal government encroaching on the power of the states is not only, you know, looking at the Constitution of the 10th Amendment that there's powers and titles of the states, but I think it goes back to being Congress being Congress. What we've got right now is a Congress that is allowing most everything to go along, and it thinks it has to dominate the field. Unfortunately, today we saw that in a Supreme Court decision on immigration, which I just disagree with, in the sense of that Arizona had the right to do what they did. I believe there's certain areas that we've got to look at, but one of the big topics in that decision was this thing called preemption. Well, the federal government has preempted the plague bill. I think, and as was said earlier, I think the government, and especially in Congress, needs to get back and need to back up out of what they're doing and leave it to the states to regulate. Right now, they're trying to dominate everything, and we've got to move back, and how we do that is by oversight and really the constitutional role of Congress. The constitutional role of Congress is to appropriate the monies and to oversight how those monies are spent, how the executive branch does it. We've got to get back to that. We've not done that in 25 plus years. Congress has got to get back to this constitutional role.
Mr. Fitzpatrick?
It's going to require the Congress to stand up and actually have a backbone and tell the executive branch that no, you cannot keep making power grabs, and to tell the judicial branch that you cannot legislate from the bench. Only the legislature, the national legislature, has the authority to make laws. The president actually does not have the authority to issue the executive orders that have somewhat of the effect of law. So the Congress is going to have to stand up and say no. And that is going to require us to return to the original intent of the Constitution. The federal government has very limited and very specific powers assigned to it. It is the states who have the numerous and unlimited powers. We must return to the place to where the federal government is out of our lives and return the power to the states as set forth in the 10th Amendment.
I think that's where we're at. It goes back to understanding how, you know, the functions work, whether it's on the state level or the national level. There is a process set up in which the legislature has an important role, the Congress has an important role, the executive has an important role, and the judicial has an important role. What we've had recently is, has been stated even in the last debate, is Congress abdicating that role. And what we've got to do is begin to rein that in. And one of the biggest ways you do that is with the power of the purse. I mean, and that's the quickest way to do that.
We have got to have members of Congress who actually understand the powers that are set forth in the Constitution. And I believe if you were to ask and make a poll of members of Congress and ask them, for instance, the phrase separation of church and state, where is it found in the Constitution, I would dare say you'd have several that would whip out the Constitution and try to find out where it is. Well, folks, it's not in there. So we need to have members of Congress who do know and understand what is in the Constitution and the powers given to the federal government.
This next question will be for Mr. Fitzpatrick. Do you think Congress should have term limits?
Yes, sir. I would advocate for term limits, and I understand that the Founding Fathers did not set forth that in the Constitution, but neither did they set forth that members should be in Congress for 40, 50 years. We have become the age of a career politician, and that is never what our Founders intended. What they intended, while there were some that were in politics, in government for their adult life, what they advocated for was that men and women nowadays go serve in the government for a period of time and come home. And if it felt like it, then later on, go back, serve some more, come home. Citizen servant, not politician. So I would advocate for 10-year limit on the House and a 12-year limit on the Senate.
Congress, do you believe Congressmen should have term limits?
I think what at this point in time is the Constitution set out our the way we do elections. I would not be in favor of term limits, but I would favor a constitutional amendment if that's the way that it came before the Congress did. But that's the only way you can set a term limit. We've tried to do this by law, and it's unconstitutional because it's in the Constitution how we do our elections. The one thing, and I made this statement on many occasions, I said it goes back to the people being a part of the process. What we've done is not only has Congress abdicated a role, but a lot of times they're in different states, in different areas, is we've got to get back to elections. What I have found for me is that elections are working. In Georgia, in the last 10 years, the House and the Senate, Georgia General Assembly, there's been an 86% turnover. In the U.S. House, there's been a 60-plus percent turnover. The elections are working. What we've got to do is begin to hold our elected officials accountable, and we've got to be engaged. This is what these meetings are about. This is what elections are about, and I believe that's the best way to go about it.
Mr. Patrick?
In the last debate, you talked about the repeal of the 17th Amendment, and one of the reasons that we have that amendment in the first place is because of the level of corruption that we have in Congress. And sad to say, we have a constituency, by and large, who is disengaged in the United States. And the only way that we can really get career politicians back under control is to have a law that limits them. Because, you know, I wish the constituency was awake enough to be able to take care of it, but not everybody's in this room. You see how many empty seats we have.
Mr. Collins?
I think that's the process, and I think what we have, looking at it, is it goes back to, so what do we want in limits? I think the Constitution preserves that. I think that's where we need, you know, to stand with it, because there are some unintended consequences that when you look at term limits. Believe me, term limits is not your easy solution, and I don't care what congressman or anybody else who stands and tells that, that's not the easy solution. I mean, because you're going to have issues of when you look at what is going on and how it's going on. It goes back to the character of the people you elect and being a part of the process, and that's where I stand with this.
Can we have another round?
Yes, sir. You're our skilled debaters, I'm sure it'll make its way back in. Mr. Collins.
Yes.
Do you support the U.S.'s continued presence in Afghanistan? What do we need to do to win this conflict?
As someone who has served in this 11-year war, whether it be in Iraq or Afghanistan, I think the problem we've got right now is we don't have a clearly defined role. And I think what we're trying to do, and what I really disagree with this president is we are putting, we're beginning to, one, we're setting, you know, what I saw, false deadlines or true deadlines, and we're saying we're going to be moving out. I believe what we've got to come to a place is to find a way to bring our folks home. And we've got to do so in a way in which bring them home in an orderly fashion, in a way that protects them, but also protects what we invest in. Afghanistan is a true problem, and has been for not just the last 11 years, but for the last, you know, hundreds of years if you look at their involvement. How we do that, though, is we've got to give clear direction. What we've not had in this administration or from Congress is a direction in how we want to go. People all the time are upset at, you know, where we're at in the wars. The problem is this: Congress has the ability at any time to begin to bring them home by cutting off the money, and it happened.
Our founding fathers had a philosophy of separatism without isolationism, and what that means is they were not going to get entangled in the affairs of other nations. They weren't going to totally isolate themselves, but they were going to separate. And I've got to ask the question, is the life of one more man, one more woman, one more of our children worth the continued presence in either of those wars? Yes, we were attacked. And yes, we needed to have a response. But to be there for 10 years, 11 years, when's it gonna stop? What is gonna be the final straw that says that's the limit of the cost that we're gonna have? Folks, we have spent way too much in terms of lives. I'm not even gonna talk about money, because lives are so much more important. But the lives of our men and women who serve in the military are so precious, and we must protect them.
Mr. Collins, follow up?
I think it just goes back to leadership, and I think that's one of the things that we're lacking, you know, right now in Congress, and especially with this presidency, and it's something I'm concerned about. I think that, and I applaud, you know, Roger for his background with the Marines, and also being in the Air Force myself. I see this every day, and what we've got to come up to is we've got to have the leadership to maintain our role as being the strongest nation in the world, that power where we need to, and then come home. So,
sad to say that war is many times very political, and instead of letting the generals get out there and do what they do best, they are hindered by policymakers. And we need to have leadership, whether that be in the House, White House, or in the Congress, that actually sets the priorities of when, and not play political games.
Thank you, sir. This next question will be for Mr. Fitzpatrick. What will you to address the current crisis of illegal immigration? Pardon? What will you do to address the current crisis of illegal immigration?
Oh my goodness, that is such a complicated thing, but the where you have got to start is this. We are a nation of laws. And what that means simply is, if it's a law, obey it. If it's a bad law, change it. But so long as it is a law, you obey it. And what this president has done is he has snubbed his nose at the rule of law, and Congress cannot allow that president to continue to do what he has, and that is violate the Constitution and the limited powers that the executive branch has. Now, I am more than willing to sit down and discuss and come to some kind of a solution on what immigration needs to be. But at the very least, we must expect people to come here legally. And if you are not here legally, then you have violated the law, and they can be no different than if I were to have broken the law. There have to be consequences if you broke the law of the United States of America.
Promise, do you need to repeat the question?
No, I think what we've got to look at here is really the sad state of, and I'll answer this issue in our country, that in which we have states who are having to pass laws, and we did just the last session, House Bill 87, in which we addressed illegal immigration in the state of Georgia because of the cost and because of the issues, and really where we said in the state that we are going to put a parameter on who and the how you live here legally. The problem we have right now is it's been put to the states. The federal government has not acted. The federal government has pandered. The federal government said we'll do it. You know, the president said we'll do it on a case-by-case basis. We'll have others that have said that we'll just let this group in if they meet certain requirements. And what we've not had is coming together and saying we've got to enforce the law. House Bill 87, which was passed in Georgia, which, by the way, was pretty much intact, upheld today in the Supreme Court. The reason is we attacked the very root of immigration problems, and that was the jobs and the job situation, and said, here's what we want to do in the state of Georgia. That's what we got to do in Washington.
Mr. Fitzpatrick, can I add anything?
What I'd like to add is we need to have members in Congress that are actually there to do what is right rather than what it's going to take to get reelected. Many times, and I believe that this is the root reason for what the president did. In his announcement on immigration, he wanted to gain votes. He wanted to get reelected. And we need to tackle the tough problem of immigration by doing what is right, regardless of whether it loses votes or not.
Mr. Collins,
I think, and what was just said there, then it goes back, I think we just don't want to do what's hard. And this is not an easy answer. I wish life could be summed up in a bumper sticker. It can. But what we got here, especially with immigration, is something that you tackle. And whether it's on the federal level or the state level, these are votes that we have to have. These are things that we have to work on, because if we don't, then our borders become porous, political gain is given, and in the end, our country is the worse off.
Mr. Collins, you lead off this next question. Can the federal budget be balanced without raising taxes? If so, how?
Yes. And the is a simple way. The way you do it is like everybody else in this room. If you have a problem with your spending, you cut your spending. The problem's not income in our country. The problem is our spending problem. And the problem is right now we're spending over $1 trillion more than we bring in. This cannot continue to happen. This is what I said, if you remember back when we first started. I said, this is an election not about the next couple of years. This is about an election that's going to define the next generation. I've said it on many occasions. The reason I'm in this race is three reasons. It's Jordan, Copeland, and Cameron. They're my kids. Because they're going to pay the price for what we do in spending or what we don't do in spending. How we begin is we begin to take out, you can begin to take out government agencies, and that's fine, but you can take out almost all the government agencies and still not get us balanced. We've got to take on the bigger picture of our Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. If we don't take that on, then there's no way we can begin to. And then we got the debt, our payment. But until we get our deficit, we can't deal with the debt. So it can be done, but it's going to have to make tough choices, and people are going to have to understand.
Patrick, can the federal budget be balanced without raising taxes, and if so, how?
Yes, sir. And we can do it now, or we can do it later. You remember the old commercial, you can pay me now, or you can pay me later. And the whole gist of that commercial was, is you pay a little bit of pain now, or a whole lot of pain later on. Now, and I tell you what, I fear for this republic, if we continue down this road much longer. Because we are now over 100% of our GDP in terms of debt. And if we continue in this vein, then we will be going the way of Greece. And let me ask you this, what do you think the effect of this economy going belly up is going to have on the economy of the world? We must, for our own preservation, get our house in order. And if that means paying right now, then we must do it, because I'd rather have a small amount of pain now than a larger amount later on.
Yeah, I think so. And I think it goes back to experience. And I think that's what in Georgia, we've lost over $5 million in revenue over the last few years. And one of the things that you got to do is you got to learn to cut. And we talk about cutting agencies all day long, what you want to do. Well, the fact of the matter is there's one candidate in this race who has actually cut an agency, and that's me. I sponsored a bill over 3 years ago, and it was passed this past year. The governor signed it, in which we eliminated the state personnel agency. We eliminated 40 jobs. We cut $2.6 million out of the budget, and we were able to use that to fund other priorities. That's what conservative action is, and that's what we've got to do in Washington.
You know, I would advocate for the elimination of some agencies and departments, Department of Education, EPA, IRS, implement the fair tax. But like you said, that still would not balance the budget, so we are still going to have to look at Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. Even defense, we can look at that, make it stronger, but be smarter while we're doing it.
Collins. No, Mr. Collins, thank you. Mr. Fitzpatrick, if the current majorities hold in the 2012 elections, which means if the Democrats maintain control of the Senate and maintain the presidency, how do you intend to affect change in D.C. with those establishments?
Well, obviously, you have to start with where you are and then working within the House. So working with all members of the House of Representatives to make sure we pass legislation that's going to be in the best interest of the United States. What is to prevent, maybe there are rules, I don't know, I've never been there, but what would prevent someone from the House having dinner or something with somebody from the Senate and having a conversation? And, you know, there's a scripture that says, come, let us reason together. You know, it makes a lot of sense to just sit down with someone regardless of what the difference in views are and have a discussion. If we can come to some kind of middle ground that is going to move our country forward. You know, I appreciated the last debate when every time I got 3 yards in a cloud of dust reminded me of Vince Neil football. And yes, I would love to be able to just take care of everything in one fell swoop, but sometimes, yes, you must do 3 yards in a cloud of dust.
Just before you answer, I want to clarify, we're not advocating for that. We certainly are doing all we can with the Republican Party, and I'm sure that that's not the situation in which you all end up going to Congress with. But in the event the nuclear option happens and you end up having to go to D.C., Mr. Collins, how do you intend to affect change in D.C., the Democratic control Senate, the Democratic president?
Well, I think what you've got to look at, and again, we're all, in this room, going to be working toward President Romney and a Senate that we're going to go to the place and get everything the Senate works with. If we do not, what we've got to do is I make the statement in several places, and I throw the numbers out here. Anybody know what 218, 60, and 1 is? Except my kids. 218, 60, and 1 is what it takes to get a bill passed. 218 in the House, 60 in the Senate right now. I don't really think they need to keep that rule, but then 60 in the Senate, and one person sign it. What we've got right now is a logjam in Washington in which we're moving things out of the House and they're stacking up in the Senate. If your scenario plays out, you're going to have a similar process. What I would like to do is find the ones in the House that we passed legislation that need to be, which has already been passed, but also find the things that we can agree on. And this comes back to an understanding of how you work together in a process. There's been many things from the budget perspective. There's been many things that have been dealt even in other areas in which Democrats and Republicans have both said, here's areas where we agree. Well, we've got to work toward finding solutions and be also willing to take a vote. And this is something that I've had to do before, is take a vote that you need to take a vote, take what is right, stand, and then come home and explain that. And then how this works together and how we move progress along. I think right now we're not doing that.
You know, since the Republicans took control of the House 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, you know, all the compromise has been on whose part? The Republicans. You know, I don't see any of the Democrats compromising. And so to say something that we're going to compromise for the good of the country, well, I tell you what, if it's compromised, both sides give up something. And we must make sure that we do not give up more than what the other side gives up.
Yeah, I think that is, and it goes back to our spending and the issues that we've had, whether it be other issues. I think what we've got to do is if you're going to have cuts, you have the cuts, and we've got to make the cuts and not put them off and say, well, we're going to do this, we'll have this vote later, we've got to have those cuts and not give in on those issues that we just find, especially as Republicans, find to be our core standards.
This next question will be for Mr. Collins. Are there any federal departments you would support consolidating or eliminating?
This has been the great discussion question over the presidential election and all, and I think we've discussed, I think, EPA, education, you know, and the ones that we can, and energy that we can go on. But I want to say, again, this goes back to what I say is experience and looking at those areas where you can. One of the things right now that you can do, and it was mentioned earlier in a presentation, but I want to take it a step further, is we can begin to actually scale down federal government with the Department of Transportation. Instead of just being Georgia being a donor state, let's actually take action to begin to move this money that has been sent up and block grant it back to Georgia where we know how to spend it, and we can spend it on things that are better suited to Georgia instead of expanding a federal bureaucracy, which has grown way too large and has been around for more years than it was ever intended to be. We can begin right there. Let's begin to take that down. This was Tom Graves' proposal. This is something that he has been working on as well. There's others that have. It's right now it's holding up the transportation bill. Let's start where we can. We can eliminate a lot of different things, but start where you can. That's what we're not having discussion. It's easy to throw out, here's what we'd eliminate. The question is, where can you actually start and begin the process then?
The beginning place where we need to start looking is what specifically in the United States Constitution is granted to the federal government. And as I've been looking at that, there are several agencies and departments that can be eliminated because they're not granted to the federal government to have. Those being Department of Energy, and they were supposed to make us energy independent by now. The IRS, the EPA, education, and there's one biggie that I think that we really seriously need to look at, and that is the Federal Reserve. Do you realize that the Founding Fathers did not want us to have a central bank, which is exactly what the Federal Reserve system is? And back almost 99 years ago, which is coming up for renewal in December, and I would suggest that we contact our congressman, do not renew the Federal Reserve. If we can do that, that would return so much of the power back to the community banks.
Mr. Collins?
I think what it goes back to here, and it's easy to come to a debate, and it's easy to talk about what departments we want to have, because bottom line is, when you get up there, you're going to have constituencies, you're going to have to actually make a hard vote, you're going to have to start beginning this process and know how to do it. That's where I believe what we've got to do is look at where we have actually been able to do that, actually where we can make these eliminations and begin to work on the hard part beyond just simply for departments to eliminate, but also look at the very core root of what our what's driving our deficits, and that's understanding we've talked about before.
You know, one of the more important things I believe that Congress can do is return some of the power back to the states. My being in education, I see firsthand the abuse of the federal government and regulations. You want our money, then the hooks come with it, is what the federal government says. And while I fully advocate for the elimination of any unrequired services, as in whatever's not in the Constitution, I would also advocate for a reduction in the number of hooks to go along with it if the money still continues to flow.
Thank you. Mr. Fitzpatrick, you lead off this question. What is your solution to solve the Social Security system's unfunded mandates in the states?
Oh my goodness. Well, Social Security cannot be touched, I believe, for the older citizens. We cannot do that. And there needs to be some kind of a privatization of it. And it goes back to this whole deal of liberty and self-responsibility. Am I responsible for myself, or is the federal government responsible for me? So for the younger ones who are just now entering the workforce or up through probably around 35, I would advocate for some privatization. And then there's going to be, and I don't know the details of what you would do with those who are in the middle range. You know, some kind of combination of the two. But we must move towards privatization of Social Security.
Kyle?
Is the Social Security and unfunded mandates, or just the Social Security part of that?
Just the Social Security.
Just I think this is one of the general agreements we have, that right now we can actually maintain roughly 55 and above and maintain the current system that we have in Social Security. You can do that by, it still allows choice for those who are younger in this process, and by doing so, you can allow them not only the personal responsibility and the liberty and freedom to do with their retirement what they want, but also taking a small percentage to maintain. This is what's been said. Paul Ryan, many others have advocated this plan. I think that is where we can begin to move forward. What we can't do is continue to do nothing and pretend it's going to go away. that's what we can't do. And in looking at the other thing that I would say is this, so it's going to depend on folks in this room, is when we get there and we begin to advocate real change and we begin to advocate things that are going to change the system, we can't allow the Democrats or special interest groups to simply show a picture of somebody pushing grandma over the cliff and sit back and take it. We can't do that. That's not what we're talking about. We've got to have a real change, and we've got to stand up and do the change that we're talking about.
Mr. Fitzpatrick, additional comments?
Yes. This is going to be a convoluted answer, but you hopefully will see where I'm coming from. I think there's a book out there called How to Kill 11 Million People. And it sort of talks about World War II in Germany and how 11 million Jews were killed, and it's because they were lied to. And you can get a lot of stuff done, pulled over in people's eyes, if you lie to them enough. And I'm going to be straightforward with you. The cuts have to be made. And I'm not going to tell you that I'm going to protect whatever it is that you have, because I would rather this republic survive and we have less than for this public to go on down the track. So,
I think what we've got here is just what I want to continue in that process. This is going to have to be issues that are not off the table. And we as Republicans have got to maintain the pressure on this issue. We've got to continue to look at it. And Social Security is not the only one, you know, in Medicaid, Medicare, these programs that we've got to look at. These all have to be on the table as we look forward to spending as we go forward. And Social Security is one in which there is a workable solution. We just got to look a little bit.
Mr. Collins, this next question is for you. We are expecting a decision from the Supreme Court regarding Obamacare in the next couple of days. If Obamacare is sustained, if the court finds that it is not unconstitutional, how will you as a member of Congress respond?
Well, after today's decision on immigration, I'm not as hopeful. I'm still very hopeful that they will do what is right, and that's actually overturn Obamacare. And that's the hope. If not, the first thing I will do is again join with the House and vote to repeal from start to bottom. I agree with the Speaker earlier and Congressman earlier that I'm not crazy about any part of it and wanting to keep this part because it sounds good or this part because it was good for us. I think what we've got to do, though, is begin to look at it from a perspective if we're going to, you know, repeal it and be done with it, what can we do or what is being done on that level? And I think it's one is doing things on the state level, giving state control. One of the things that we passed that unfortunately that our insurance companies are waiting on this ruling is buying insurance across state lines, which has been advocated by Congressman Brown. Dr. Price also has a plan out there. I like Dr. Price's plan as it looks across the cost and how we deal with our issues of Medicare. I believe Medicaid, and I'll address that in my rebuttal, but I think there's other issues that we can look at actually working.
You know, the healthcare law had zero to do with healthcare, and it had everything to do with the power of the federal government over individuals' lives. And what I would suggest, because the question was, what would I do? All right, well, the House has already passed the repeal, so, you know, what else do you need to do? But what I would do is I would advocate for the state legislature to do whatever it can to buffet the effects of the health care law, because if the Supreme Court does not overturn it, then it goes into effect. Now, the thing of it is, though, is health care is not the United States Constitution. Therefore, the state has control over health care because of the 10th Amendment. So I would suggest that the state of Georgia take care of the state of Georgia in the state legislature.
Mr. Collins, anything additional?
Well, I think that is good, and I think the unfortunate part is when the Supreme Court rules on the constitutionality of the parts of Obamacare, that's actually going to go into law unless we actually change the law. I mean, and that's at that point, it is the law of the land. And the Supreme Court, even from Georgia, and Attorney General Sam Owens was part of the ones fighting against this, is how do we do that? We've got to get rid of it and attack it in the heart and begin to move that away from the books altogether. And that's how we have to do it. The state cannot afford this Affordable Care Act. It just will not. $2 billion is something Georgia's state budget can't have.
Federal law does not trump state law when it is not specifically given to the federal government in the Constitution. Health care is not given to the federal government in the Constitution. Therefore, the state has precedence over that issue when it comes to health care. So the state legislature can pass whatever they need to annul the federal health care law.
Mr.
And I tell you what, it's time for the states to start standing up to the federal government and not just taking it any time that somebody says something from the federal government.
That leads to an interesting question. I'll take the liberty of expanding on that. Mr. Fitzpatrick, do you believe that the states can nullify unconstitutional federal law?
The Constitution is very, very clear. There are specific powers granted to the federal government by the federal Constitution. And there's a section in the Constitution that says that the Constitution and the laws passed in the federal government are the supreme. And that's absolutely true. But see, you've got to look at that the powers are very specific and limited granted to the federal government. Now, why say that the entire federal government is supreme in every way and then have the 10th Amendment sitting over here that says if it's not specifically granted to the federal government, then it's reserved to the states unless it's specifically prohibited to the states. So we have got to look at what is given to the federal government, and if it's not specifically mentioned, then it belongs to the state. I mean, that's plain as day.
Collins, do you believe that the states can nullify federal law?
I think what we can have got to look at here, and I think, you know, this is much longer than a minute question. I think what we've had this, you know, we go back 100 plus years here, and we've had an issue of nullification. Can the states just up and do what they want to do in light of a federal law or federal decision? I think what we've got to look at in this one is the simple fact that there have been such an expansion by the judicial branch over the years, and it was talked about in the last debate, over what is constitutional, what is not, whether it be the Commerce Clause or privilege immunity, wherever you want to go with that. I think what we've got to look at is this goes back to a heart. This is why this presidential election is so important, because in the next presidential election, this president is going to be able to appoint more justices to the Supreme Court that we've got to get back to the original intent of. And I think when we look at that, that is going to restore the 10th Amendment rights when Congress says we're getting out of this as a federal government. States are able to step up, but what we simply can't do is the federal government say we're getting out of this, but we're going to force the states to do a certain amount or pay a certain amount and do this on their own. This is where we've got to look at.
Founding Fathers felt like the federal courts were the weaker of the three branches. And the reason was is because they had no power to enforce. Zero power to enforce. And I don't know if you remember a few years ago where a federal court ruled that the Ten Commandments had to be removed from the courthouses instead of Alabama. And then the governor stood up and says, if anybody shows up in my state, you'll get arrested. Guess who showed up? Nobody. Nobody showed up to actually enforce that court's rulings. And the states can take care of themselves.
Do you support raising the federal debt limit?
No. And that's a pretty simple. I think the problem is we have, I don't support it because the problem is that we're promised if we raise it, we'll cut X amount of dollars, and we just never have. My question was last year, I wanted to see what would happen the day after. That was what I wanted to see. I wanted to see what would happen the morning after the supposed limit came. What would happen? We were told that the world would end and the stars would come out in the daytime, and we'd heard all kinds of stuff. My question is, what would happen the day after? And we never got that point. Because what ended up happening is, yes, we did a little cut here, and then we threw a conference, a super committee together. We just played with it. Let's got to get back to cutting the budget where we live below the debt ceiling, which can be done. We ought to be prioritizing our payments anyway. That shouldn't be something we have to pass a special bill for to get under the debt limit. We ought to be prioritizing that. And that goes back to Congress being Congress and its oversight responsibility with its appropriation process. We haven't passed the budget so long. That's the problem.
No, I would not vote for a right raising the debt ceiling. And, you know, we do not, Mr. Collins mentioned this earlier, we do not have a revenue problem, folks. We have a spending problem. And just like you would do in your own household, if you run out of money, then you stop your spending. And that's what we've got to force the federal government to do, stop the spending.
Mr. Carlton, any addition?
This goes back to the very heart of where we're at. And it goes back to the heart of understanding that you can't keep playing with our children's futures in the budgetary process. And it's not a matter of priorities. This ought to be done already. It's not a matter of having to do a special law. It's a matter of doing what you're sent there to do, and that is cut your spending, get your balance, your budget in order, and move forward for what's good for the country. And that's what we got to do.
And you cannot raise a ceiling with promises of cuts 10 years down the road. Cuts must be now. They cannot be 10 years later. Do not raise the debt ceiling and do not offer cuts down the road. Cuts must happen now.
Speaking of promises of the tax map, there was also discussion of a vote on the balanced budget. Mr. Fitzpatrick, do you support a balanced budget in the federal constitution?
Absolutely. I support a balanced budget amendment, but let me tell you this. Just because Congress is, you know, and actually, I don't know if Congress has respect for the rule of law in the first place, because their one responsibility is to pass a budget, and they have it. But that being said, if there is an amendment to the Constitution that says that Congress must balance a budget, what is going to prevent Congress from raising taxes in order to balance the budget? You know, that's great. Let's have a balance the budget amendment. But there is absolutely nothing that is going to stop Congress from increasing the amount of taxes that you have to continue the spending spree. What we must have are men and women in Congress who are going to say no to spending increases and yes to paring back the size of the federal government so that it is actually doing the job that it was supposed to do in the first place.
Mr. Collins, do you agree with the question?
No, I would agree with the balanced budget amendment. I think that's something that we have here in Georgia. I think it would be good on the federal level as well. But I think in response to the question, I agree, is what would keep them, you know, what keep a Congress from raising taxes? My answer to that is voters. And I think what we've seen in the last, especially the last couple of years in response to what has happened in Washington, is voters becoming more informed, voters being a part of our Tea Party movement, our conservative Republican movement. That's the very things that we've got to continue to bring out. I believe that's what will hold us accountable as we move forward. I'm also an optimist in this sense as well. I believe that when you look at where we are in our spending, when you look at where we are in our economy, we have got to come together and people will say this is where we have to move forward and we've got to balance it because there is no alternative. This isn't something we can continue to play with. We've got to actually have a real solution.
No response.
Very good. Mr. Collins, do you have anything else you want to give you the full benefit of your time?
I appreciate it.
All right. This next question is for Mr. Collins. Do you support gay marriage? Would you support an amendment to the U.S. Constitution requiring that only heterosexual marriages between two people be the only marriages recognized in the United States?
No, I do not support gay marriage. I do not support civil unions. And yes, I would support an amendment, and here's why. Because right now, in our federal system, we have a president and also a Congress who wants to pass basically policy through legislation or through the income tax code or however you want to do it. I believe right now that it is easy in our society, especially with the president who wants to seemingly be everything to everybody, he would promote that gay marriage is acceptable. He leaves off, and when I say that, I disagree with gay marriage, but I also disagree with civil unions. And civil unions simply is wanting to take the same rights and privileges and apply them to marriage. It's the same, to me, it's just a code word for gay marriage. You can't have that. And for me, that's just a matter of standing up for traditional values, and that's what I believe we've got to happen, because right now we have a policy in which we like to social engineer through our legislative process.
In the beginning, God created Adam and Eve, and throughout the history of mankind, societies have recognized that marriage is between one man and one woman. Well, let me rephrase that, between men and women. Now, in the United States, we respect that one man, one woman, marriage is the law of the land. And it is not incumbent upon us to do anything contrary to what God has set forth as to be right. I agree. I do not support civil unions in any way. The federal government should in no way, and I believe states should do the same thing, should not in any way recognize homosexual behavior as being sanctioned through civil unions or marriage at the federal or the state level.
Collins, would you like to add anything?
I think in continuing the conversation, I think that it is just a stand for four values, and I don't believe that's a Georgia value or a California value. I believe that's our country value, and it's just something that I believe that we need to stand for. And that's just the position that I believe we need to take to protect those values in such as life as we discussed earlier.
Fitzpatrick, any question?
I would support a constitutional amendment naming the law of the land to be one man, one woman. But I would suggest that that's not entirely necessary. If we can just encourage through our churches and specifically our churches, proper teaching of what is right and what is wrong. You know, heterosexual marriage is right and homosexual relationships are wrong. And we must teach our children that that's the case.
Mr. Fitzpatrick. Actually, I'm getting a little off on my question here. I'm actually starting to have a problem, so I guess this is yours. Let's close out our debate session. What is your top legislative priority for next Congress?
Top legislative priority, I believe, there's so much to do, and I almost wondered about whether we need to have one big bill, just one big fix. No, we have got to get our spending under control. That's a no-brainer there. But we've got to work on shrinking the size of the federal government. And we have got to work on recognizing that the Constitution is the law of the land and obeying it according to the original intent. And I would suggest that Congress could spend a lot of time looking at what is already on the books and repealing a lot of whatever is being imposed on the people. So spending time repealing those acts that are cumbersome on the American people, passing a budget, shrinking the size of government, those would be my priorities.
Mr. Talbot?
For me, it would be as what we just talked about a few minutes ago, the balance, one would be balanced budget, but then it's also the budget itself. Is actually putting out in a budget that actually is workable, it is passed, but also passing all the appropriation bill. I've said this before in this debate, I'm going to say it again. It goes back to Congress doing what Congress is supposed to do. And we haven't since the late 90s, when there was another Democrat president, actually passed all the parts of the appropriations package. We've not done that. And why? Because it's so much easier just to pass one, and we'll pass defense because it looks good, we want to support the troops, or we'll pass another one because we want to handle it. So what we end up doing is we wrap everything up into one continuing resolution. We've got to get back to true oversight and true budgeting. If we don't do that, then we're never going to get a handle on it. It's always going to come down to the end. We'll say, well, it's just quicker let's just throw this tree in together, or two trees in together, and then we'll cut 2% off the top, and we all did a good job. No, we've got to actually understand how to do work the budget and actually get into that process again.
Mr. Fitzpatrick.
I wonder if many times what the Congress does is for political gain, and Mr. Collins was talking about how they do piecemeal the work of the budget. You know, is it because they pass the budget so that is more out there, therefore, you know, they want to support those who support the defense? You know, I don't know. It's hard to read the heart of a person. But we must, why don't we just do the budget all at one time and get it done at that time? Makes perfect sense to me.
Mr. Collins, any questions?
I think just in addition, I think one of the things we've got to work on is just destroying our tax code and start over. I mean, we've got to, our tax code is the thing that's inhibiting our economy, it's inhibiting our process fair tax for me. But there's also another one we want to repeal. We need to repeal Dodd-Frank. We need to get our banking system back going, because that's one of the things that's just killing us right now is the lack of being able to move in our monies, and we've got to continue to do that.
Well, gentlemen, as we sometimes jokingly say, everybody in Forsyth County runs as a Republican. We want to ask you to make sure, in the 2008 presidential election, who did you gentlemen vote for in the general election?
I voted for Senator Bennett.
Mr. Collins?
I voted for him.
Very good. Well, thank you, gentlemen, very much. We appreciate your time. Now we've come to the closing segments. Mr. Collins will start first. You have a minute and a half to close.
Thank you. It has been good tonight. This is I felt like almost an additional crossfire tonight. This was great. The questions coming at us and going back and forth. I think what we've got to have is we definitely have a change. But I want to just, as we look at what we're dealing with and where we're going in this election, this is an important election. And you being here tonight means something. And you being here to listen tonight, and those who may or may not listen on the internet, it means something. And I think that is a part of what being a congressman is about. Congressman, what I'll actually talk about being constituents. And I believe going to Washington is being one person for 700,000 who couldn't make it there on that day. And I want to say, one, I appreciate Roger being here tonight. I know he actually changed something on his schedule. And I appreciate the Colonel being here to speak for Martha. But I do also have an issue there. It is maybe a briefing, but if you want to go to the CPAC website, it's a fundraiser tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Martha's at a fundraiser in Washington, D.C. She's already up there in Washington dealing with the same groups that she wants not to deal with down here. And so I'm glad that you're here tonight, and it's a good part to be here, because this is the kind of congressman I want to be, is one who listens, one who's a part, and also is for the last 6 years stood up and answered for votes that I made and answered the questions of the people. So tonight has been great to be a part of this. I'll be here afterwards. We always stay late to try and answer questions. If you have any questions of our records, it's good to be here tonight. But again, I want to thank the chairman of the Republican Party and thank Roger for being here as well.
It's been a pleasure as always to sit here and talk things over with Mr. Collins. He has great ideas. I've got a better idea. You know, I believe that our brighter days are in front of us. The brighter days are in front of us. And the reason is because I think the American people are waking up. At the 2008 election, we saw the birth of the Tea Party. And what that is ordinary, everyday citizens waking up and saying to our federal government, no, what you're doing is wrong. You can't go no further. And because we have a government that is of the people, by the people, and for the people, that Tea Party movement is what America is all about. Standing up and saying no to the government. I applaud those who have done so. And we are going to take our country back. Because, you know, I tell you what, even though I am running to be in the government, I'm also a citizen. And as a citizen representative, what I will do is I will stand up to the federal government, even as you do as constituents, and say, no, you cannot do that. I ask for your vote, either in early voting or on July 31st, so that I may represent you in Congress. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. We appreciate your time very much.
I'll grab it.